And in the Catholic Church, these kind of documents are quite a common thing as far as I understand.
Yes, we do have a long, rich tradition. And I've seen, for instance, that in the Orthodox document, the document of the Orthodox Church, that a lot of, be it for instance on work, be it on church and nation, be it on, let us say, on war, peace, and so on, a lot of inspiring ideas coming from Catholic social documents have been introduced into the document, but not without, let us say, transforming it in the language of the Orthodox Church. And that's therefore, let us say, that's very interesting to study right. Such. Let's say, if you look to the document, the main document, I immediately asked my students to study it in a seminar. Because we studied the different chapters. Huh? It's, let's say, what is surprising to me is that the general relationship between church and state, that the way the Orthodox Church is looking to that relationship is very similar to the way Catholics are looking to that relationship. Moreover, let us say, I have to agree, better than you will find in the teachings of the Catholic Church, the document starts with theological roots. What are the theological roots? Eh? And what could be expected from the church? What could the church contribute, let us say, to the common good of or the well-being of society? Yeah. That's one of it starts saying, and that's of course an idea well known in the Orthodox tradition, but not that known, or that there is no similar idea in the Catholic Church. It starts with saying that it's only in and through the church that creation will be deified. Thus, the church consider itself as the body of Christ, the new humanity in Christ. It's separated from the world. Thus, it's a kind of mixed. It's divine and human at the same time, and it presents the teaching of the church as a kind of bearing witness to Christ, and therefore, let us say, it tries to be involved or to participate in all kinds of life in society. Does that's an idea which you will, let us say, fulfilling through its tasks, the mission of salvation within society. That kind of ecclesiological position, you can study that in, let's say, in the Catholic tradition, but it does not belong to the Catholic social tradition. It's more, let us say, covered in ecclesiology. Maybe you are familiar with the fact that within the Catholic Church, I'm referring here to the second chapter of the document on mm-hmm. church and nation. In the Catholic Church, we are not that familiar with, we often use the notion nation and nationality, but we normally have in mind, in the tradition, we normally have in mind, let us say, a kind of nation state. What is surprising in the document of the Orthodox Church of Russia is the fact that immediately the notion nation is splitted up. You can understand it in two ways. I've never seen that in a Catholic document. First of all, you can understand it, the nation, as an ethnic notion, so to say, an ethnic community, referring, for instance, to the Old Testament, the people of God. It's also an ethnic Jewish community, so to say, taking that idea for granted. That's something you will have never read that in a Catholic document. And then the second notion is if you consider the citizens of a state, let us say, you can also consider the nation state. Eh? And then the document tries to combine the universal nature of the church, universality, with Christians having a national identity, referring to the autocephalous national churches. Huh? And it concludes saying that it also in other chapters it does have a lot of references to the relationship between the church and the nation state and the Russian people. By saying, for instance, that Christian patriotism should be active. This is a notion you will not find, I guess, in the Catholic social teaching. Thus, for instance, twice or three times it says that the Orthodox Church is blessing the Russian troops, that it has to convince the people that they must be willing to die for the faith and for the fatherland. Thus the fatherland, the notion of patriotism and fatherland is quite often mentioned in the document. This is the dual understanding of nation and towards an ethnic belonging and towards the nation state. This is something of interest, so to say, because one of the disadvantages in the Catholic Church, for instance, when it comes to Belgium, you do have, in our part of the country, you do have Flemish nationalism, so that's a kind of emancipation movement. And one of the difficult things, if you look back, if you, let us say, look to the history, is that there was never a good cooperation between the church and the Flemish nationalists, because the Roman Catholic Church has always been considered as being pro-nation state, and nothing to do with the ethnic belonging of the people.
I see.
You see? Mm-hmm. Thus the document also refers to the fact that the nation, be it an ethnic nation, be it a nation state, may not be considered as God. It's not replacing. There is also critique on the nation state, and it's very clearly said in the document that the Russian Orthodox Church has to oppose, I quote, aggressive nationalism, xenophobia. Those things are mentioned. Right? It's let's say a moderate acceptance of nationalism. Yeah, but giving more support than the Catholics would do, so to say. And it's probably, let's say, behind it is the ecclesiological position. Right? There's the autocephalous autonomous church versus the universal Catholic. The idea of universality within the Catholic Church. Although the Orthodox Church also presents itself as a universal church. Yeah. Does that, it's a complex theological situation.
Do you think that the differences between the social doctrines, documents in the Catholic Church and in the Orthodox Church have anything to do with the doctrinal differences? And if so, what could be those points?
I do not think that they have a doctrinal origin. Mm-hmm. When it comes, I give you maybe a few other illustrations. When it comes to labor, both viewpoints, the viewpoint of the Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church, is exactly the same. When it comes to labor, work, the right to work. Mm-hmm. For instance, the Catholic Church is defending, since Rerum Novarum, the idea that there is indeed the right to work, but the argument in favor of the right to work, the basis for it, the roots of it, or the duty to work. Mm-hmm. Everybody has, and it comes from the creation story, let us say, we have the duty to co-create. Human beings have to consider themselves in the image of God, the likeness of God, have to consider themselves as creators, co-creating, and by co-creating, fulfilling, let us say, the purposes, the aims God has with his creation. Thus the idea of the duty to work, on which the right to work is based, or take another team, the team of property, there both traditions are defending the same. Thus I would say, if you look at it from a doctrinal viewpoint, both start saying there is only one owner of the world. This is God. Eh? God owns everything. The earth belongs to God. Eh? And therefore, let us say, the earth belongs to all. Thus everyone should have resources sufficient for living, for life in dignity. And at the same time, we have a kind of, when it comes to wealth, thus the document says, wealth does not make man happy. There's a kind of distance to earthly sources. Thus this is really very similar. There is all the points in which we, let us say, in which there are distinction between both traditions, have to do, I would say, with non-doctrinal points. They have to do with ecclesiology, and that, in a certain sense, the way you see the church and the church vis-à-vis the state. I refer to the question of nationalism and the way patriotism is introduced and the way you see the military operating for the people. That's a kind of, there is a distinction there.
Would it be right to say, if an alien would come down from Mars and read the two documents, one of the Russian Orthodox and another Catholic, he would think, well, they're just basically completely the same church, just different formulations, depending on circumstances.
That could probably be the case. I'll give you another example. There is a chapter on crime and punishment and reformation.
Right.
And let us say the starting point of the Orthodox Church, like the Catholic Church, is one of the tasks of the church is service to peace. Service to peace. We have to recognize the fact that in our hearts, let's say the human person, the inner of the human person, that our heart is often darkened. And thus the church is there, let us say, to enlighten people. Even people, this enlightening could be through prevention, through education, through moral and spiritual values. That's prevention, that's the first idea. But the second idea, when you deal with criminals, for instance, or people who are in jail, then it's very similar. The church is defending, both churches are against torture, of course. Both churches are really asking for upkeeping a kind of human attitude towards suspects and towards the people in jail. For priests, for instance, for clergy, they ask a kind of pastoral sensitivity for people in jail. There is that question, it's mentioned here on page 28, about death penalty. It's exactly the same discussion. This death penalty was accepted in the past by both churches, but nowadays, and it's, let us say, it's mentioned, it's explicitly mentioned in the document, like also is the case since 2000, since in the Catholic Church, asked by John Paul II, he's asking himself, in the Catechism, maybe we should exclude death penalty because it there is no possibility for, let us say, for reformation when you, and that's not a Christian punishment. That could not be considered as an acceptable way of punishing people because punishment may not be seen as revenge. And that's that kind of idea we do have in common. The idea of the inner purification, which is always you have to give a second chance to people. You have to work in that direction. This is much more important than, Does it? The idea, we do not call it deification, but it's in the Catholic tradition. But that's behind, let us say, the position of both churches when it comes to crimes and criminality and punishment.
From your explanation, I get a very strong impression that those people who wrote the social doctrine of the Russian Orthodox Church read very carefully the documents of the Catholic Church before. What do you think?
Certainly, for instance, when you take here another topic, war and peace, you see that in fact the document is explicitly referring to the Latin tradition on the just war, the Western tradition, and it more or less takes over the proportionist reasoning behind it. Does it refers to the criteria, the jus ad bellum, and it refers to the jus in bello. Dus it keeps the criterion, for instance, of we call it the discrimination principle. You have to discriminate between combatants and non-combatants. Not any kind of means like atomic bombs or biological weapons are acceptable because they do not discriminate between civilians and combatants, and therefore they are called immoral means. Well, this idea is mentioned in the document of the Orthodox Church too. So that's it's helping each other, let us say, in order to construct, let us say, a relevant Christian position vis-à-vis peace and war. It's important to learn from each other, let us say. And what is the importance of it? Maybe I can illustrate that by giving another example. Latin Christianity suffers a lot when it comes to, I'm teaching here environmental ethics, fundamental ethics and environmental ethics. Latin Christianity suffers a lot from the fact that in the past the tradition has taken a strong, a rather strong, I would say, anthropocentric or humanocentric position. And at that point, by discussing that strong anthropocentric position, be it from the discussion with the secularity here in Western Europe, or be it from an environmental viewpoint, we could learn something from the Orthodox position, which in my eyes, in my view, never has taken that strong anthropocentric position, but defends a kind of theo-anthropocentric position. I would call it a theo-anthropocentric position. Does the human being always, it's not the autonomous human being, it's not the autonomous, but there is always, it's a relative autonomy, it's not an absolute autonomy, in the sense that in the Orthodox tradition, the human being always refers to God and what God means for us, but not only for us, but also as creator, but also for the rest of creation. That it emphasizes the human being, but not at, I would say, not in an absolute way, in a relative way, so that it is easier for the Orthodox position, I guess, to ask for care for the environment, or they could help each other, we could learn from each other. And each, which is of course, each has developed particular characteristics, but we share the same sources. That's it's open for discussion, of course.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's that mutuality in understanding the tradition which will help us for the future of Christianity.
Professor, thank you so much for this wonderful analysis,